pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Well, welcome, everybody. We're settling back in. We're back in public session, and we'll go through our agenda. We have important information to get to today. No changes to the...
No changes. Cool. We'll just be asking the table for the resolution we sent for the move. When we get to it, I'll ask...
Right, later on. Right. But it's there for... So we've approved the agenda by not changing it. So let's go to public comment period. And Chris, if you will, since you have it.
Okay, I believe we have three students here who are going to speak about a leadership conference. And I apologize in advance if I get someone's name wrong. I have Ashmir.
That's why you get to do this.
Did you say that?
Enrique.
Oh, thank you. And Jerrine?
Jerrine,
I apologize. So please.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ashmir.
Ask you to speak up, please.
Okay. My name is Ashmir Zephyr Sanchez. I go to the school, and we're here to talk about our experience in Pride Live and to thank you guys for supporting us. So a little bit of background information about Pride Live. Pride Live is the Puerto Rican Hispanic youth leadership we go to every year. So we basically recruit kids from the school and we go every year. And it was founded by Ancho Del Toro. So he was a Hispanic assembly member. He passed away, unfortunately, 23 years ago. But he was founded like 30 years ago. So the institution is here to help Hispanic kids to develop their leadership skills and also to learn more about the legislative process of New York State. He created this program to help the kids because he knew that they were the future of the country, and he basically wanted to help them to be a better citizens and help their country.
So before we went to Albany, we had to go through 5 sessions of training in Syracuse, and those trainings helped us get confidence in ourselves, how to be a great leader in our community, and how we can learn to debate on bills. And when we went to Albany, we had the opportunity to sit on an assembly member's seat. And so there is over 200 students from the United States, and we got to debate on bills. There was 4 different bills, and after, it's a lot of work, but at the end it's fun, so it's like work and fun at the same time. And so doing the trainings, we had to like have certain amounts of hours in order to go to Albany. And so we had like group activities. We also got to like research the bills and like write our debates on it. And so
My name is Enrique de Lemos. I go to the school here, and the training was amazing. All the 5 trainings were amazing. I'd like to use my friend Ash here as an example. He was completely silent the first training. You know, he didn't speak much, talk to anyone at all. And by the last weekend when we were in Albany, he got up in front of all the 199 other students who were sitting in the assembly member seats, and he spoke in front of everyone, and he presented his argument beautifully and just, you know, like, wow, so complex and everything. It was amazing. And then we also, after, got a unique opportunity to meet with the assembly members from around the state. We got to meet Mr. Brandisi. We got to meet Senator Crouch. He was a very interesting man. We got to talk to him about a lot of things. And I just thought it was so nice to make all these connections with these important and prominent figures in our community. And we also just learned so many skills about bill making, about argument building, about just, you know, building a stronger and better community for all of us.
Thank you very much.
Oh, outstanding. That's great.
Got Barbara Bergman.
That's me. So I've been taking kids to this conference for 9 years now, I think. In the beginning, I just took them to the Syracuse trainings. And then 7 years ago, the leaders in Syracuse asked me if I also wanted to go to Albany. I said, are you kidding me? Yeah, I want to go to Albany. I want to see what happens. It's really a life-changing experience for kids. One of our kids who came back as a trainer with us this year, graduated from here 3 years ago. Her senior year was not only Syracuse's Delegate of the Year, ended up being the Delegate of the Year for the whole state, and is now coming back as a trainer, is hoping to start this in Philly next year when she transfers to Temple. So it's really, really exciting. So I had a bit of a moral dilemma being here tonight because it's Passover and I don't usually work on Passover. But A, I didn't want the kids to have another 2 weeks to wait before they got to tell you about this. And the other thing was that what I wanted to say really fits in with the holiday, is kind of connected to it, with the spirit of the holiday, and to the Institute. So I kind of just felt like I was going to go for it. When we were in Albany, we're joined by many movers and shakers from state ed and from state government who speak to us about diversity and about welcoming the newcomer. They riled the kids up about the DREAM Act and about the right to reach for the stars. What does this have to do with Passover? The holiday commemorates the Jews finally gaining their freedom from slavery in Egypt, but wandering the desert for 40 years homeless. One of the main tenets of the holiday is to welcome the strangers among us and to invite them to our tables. I think we have a unique moment in New York State Ed to make a difference. Our state government is welcoming. Our education system, I think, has a never-before preponderance of wonderful women in places of power that are uniquely attuned to these needs. The assembly people we met with were equally responsive from both sides of the aisle. We also have a newly appointed regent in our very own Suniva. A theme I heard repeated many times during that Albany weekend from assembly people as well as educators, and I've heard several times around this table, is the need for more mental health services for our children in our schools. I don't know if my background is in psychology, in family sociology, and in education, so that's really where my heart is. I very recently attended a 2-day conference on supporting the social and emotional development of English learners. The speaker reported on years of research already coming out of Canada. We know we need new types of educational programs as Ithaca welcomes refugees. As we were trying to teach the students in the program, we need to make our voices heard through the channels afforded to us. I think we have a unique opportunity and a unique responsibility, so I decided to come and say that tonight. I am more than happy to share the names of the people who joined us in Albany or we visited with in their offices the next day. Thanks.
Thanks.
Robert Chapman?
Yes, sir. Thank you. That's a very hard act to follow, but I'll do my best. So thank you, Ms. Transley. Thank you, Dr. Brown, for the opportunity of letting us speak. My name is Robert Chapman. I'm the secretary of the Ithaca Substitutes Association, and from the young lady sitting over here in the green to my other colleague over here in the black, these are all members of the association. We're here tonight to express our deep appreciation for our contract and for the ability that the contract has afforded us to improve our professionalism and to also improve the our ability in the classroom to move forward the children's education. Thanks to this contract, we've been able to institute a very almost unique, a very unusual program of training for subs. We call it Sub 101. Ms. Lausch was one of the major people in developing the curriculum. It covers introducing ourselves to the children, administrative duties as subs, different ways to prepare for the lessons that we have to deliver for the day, and different ways of drawing in the children in our lessons. We've trained about 180, I believe, of the 250 subs that are registered for the district. We have begun a sub 102 program where we're working on classroom management and improved subjects in classroom management and using the technology that's available in the classrooms. So again, I want to express our appreciation with the board and the administration for your help with this, and our anticipation of a continuing productive relationship with you all. So thank you very much.
Thank you. That's a very nice follow-up to the kids. So that's excellent. We appreciate that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
No one else
signed
up? That's it. Everyone who signed up. Anyone else wish to speak before we move on? Students in the back with nothing else to do? I guess not right now, but it's very good. We'll move on. LECS? We have two at once. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so tech rehearsals for Hamlet will be starting during spring break. It's an entirely student-directed and student-run performance. And the performances will be on April 28th, 29th, and 30th at LACS, and we invite you all to attend. The Guatemala trip is hosting a concert at LACS this Friday from 7 to 10 p.m., and that will feature local student bands. The Horses and Semi Soundless will be opening for the Ithaca Bottom Boys, who are made up of all LACS alumni, and you're also welcome to come to that.
And that's $6 at entry, just so you know. Guatemala Trip also hosted a Latin dance night. This was public, and we had people come and dance salsa and eat salsa, and it was good. And then a few students are going to be presenting at the Pippi to Ripley Festival conference at IC on April 21st and 22nd. This conference involves focus on gender in imaginative fiction. So one of my friends is presenting on fascism in the fifth Harry Potter movie versus the book. It's that type of nerdy, cool thing. and later on in the beginning of May, some students at LACS through a teacher are going to be reading their own personal poetry at the Spring Rites Festival.
Very good. That was a lot, so thank you. Ithaca High.
All right. We've had an exciting couple of weeks since we last met. Specifically, not only do we have successes in sports, but also our drama program had very positive showing in their recent performance in sports. Track had a meet last Saturday in which both boys and girls won. It was a invitational, so there were several meets, and they went out against their main competitors, Wego and Manuel. And additionally, boys lacrosse has a game today, and girls lacrosse has a game at Binghamton tomorrow. And for our drama club, they had an amazing performance, Anything Goes, last Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I hope you guys made it out, but it was a fantastic performance. Not only did we have some amazing actors, but we had phenomenal singers, and it was a real treat.
So we also have a few updates from our math department. So a few competitive successes. The IHS math team attended NISMA, which is the New York State Mathematics League competition in New York City. Their team took second place overall in the state, and we're very proud of that. The Ithaca High School Developers team took first place at Cornell's annual computer programming competition in Cornell. And this week is also Math Awareness Week, during which students can answer questions, different math-related questions every day to try to win a student-designed t-shirt that features a gecko Apollonian gasket, which is a mathematics one. So increase math awareness.
This Friday in activities, Code Red will be hosting a blood drive. They mentioned a huge deficit in blood banks, and they urgently need blood. So they have sign-ups in the cafeteria Tuesday through Thursday during lunch periods, and we hope a lot of people will turn out to donate. And also, last Wednesday, we held our annual election meeting run by Mr. Molander. There were many students who showed up eager to take part in the democratic process, and they had opportunity to sign up for running for class office, student council, and representative to the board positions. And and in the upcoming weeks they will campaign and we will collect your computers.
Excellent. Thanks, Cynthia. Hi, board responses. And
I
have
to say, I did get to see the play. It was fabulous.
Anyone else? Brett?
I was happy to see the play. It was a great, great show. I'd invite anybody on a sunny spring day to come down to the athletic fields. You'll see something. Yesterday, drove by, stopped off. There was a baseball game underway. There was a tennis match underway. I believe the class was practice. I don't think they had a game underway that day. But soon there'll be JV contests going on in the late afternoon and so forth. So if you want, on a sunny day, you want to see kids, and there's a sport you like, we probably have somebody playing it. Come down and take a look. I invite folks to come see it. It's great. I appreciate our substitutes stopping tonight. That's great. I'm glad to hear the response to the professional development expansion in your contract.
Over, go ahead.
Just want to echo thanks for the subs. The conversation was different when I first started. We were beginning to twist arms and tell you all what we needed. And the consistent response was, how do you expect us to spin gold out of straw, right? So hopefully this is moving in the right direction. And let's hope you do not stop asking us for things. To the young students, I really appreciate you guys coming to share your particular story. We all have stories around this table. I don't often tell mine, but I've begun to share with a few people about my elementary school and where I actually came from. 700 kids, 80% free and reduced lunch, 66% Latino, more languages than I can count. And this was in the 70s, when things were literally burning in New York City. I simply wouldn't be here unless it were for programs like that to help me make the transition. That's just reality. It doesn't matter how strong your family is. It doesn't matter how intent you are changing your circumstance. Sometimes you actually need people to take you on the inside and show you how the machine works. But you have to understand that comes with a different expectation. I can remember my before and after moments. It sounds like this is one of those moments. So now our expectations of what you do with this new knowledge and public speaking capacity, right, and understanding that you have to play a role in the matrix, we're going to expect things from you now. And you did that to yourself.
You have to be careful. You might end up on a school board someday.
I'd like to echo everyone's sentiment. Thank you very much to the substitutes. Thank you for taking the time to come out tonight. We appreciate it. I think we have worked hard to be collaborative and ever expand on the focuses to benefit children. And I think you guys do an amazing job to help us do that. For the students, I love hearing the word leadership. It's something that I believe in, and you know, to echo something that Dr. Brown once said, if not now, when? If not who? If not you, then who? You know, Eldridge said it well, but my question and my direct challenge to you is, who are you going to bring along? You know, you can never do it alone. You have some obligations. You'll have people looking up to you. So who are you going to bring along with you next? And to Ms. Bergman, thank you very much. Appreciate you taking the time out. And, you know, this is a very special evening for you, so thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Pat, anything?
I'm good.
Okay, good. Yeah, I'm just going down the line.
What they said.
Yeah, there you go. Dittos all around. But if nothing else, we'll move on to the rest of our agenda, which is fairly lengthy. Consent. Agenda.
I'll move the consent as presented.
Second.
Second by Pat. Anything to speak to?
No, not really. Just one of the shorter consents.
Yeah, really? Yeah, it's only a few pages.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good opportunity to take off. So. Before we're not deep into the kind of discussion yet. So moved, seconded. I think we're all good on the couple of pages. Nothing out of the ordinary. All in favor? That is everyone. We are a party of eight. We do, Sean unfortunately could not be here tonight, so we're 8 out of 9. So as we vote tonight, we will be voting 8 out of 9. So Dr. Round, I think we're ready for you.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity, Mr. Anderson.
And we're, we expect to have, probably hear more from you, Dr. Round, tonight than we usually do. Yeah. So
we'll keep rolling.
Yes.
Well, it's always good to tune into a board meeting from home or via the audience because you hear things here first. Two things you're going to hear tonight for the first time. One, I'm announcing that we just learned this week that for the fifth consecutive year, we've been named one of the top communities for music education in the nation. So we will be putting out a press release hopefully tomorrow or the next day. But yeah, this is a spectacular award yet again. And for 5 years in a row, we've been recognized by the National Association for Music Merchants as one of the best communities for music education in the nation, which is pretty cool. So congratulations to David Brown and all of the music educators in our school district and the amazing young people who were on display just this past weekend doing great work. Secondly, the other thing you're hearing here first, after about 6 months of development, our commitment to two-way communication and dialogue, you've seen that with enhancements to our social media presence, 3 different redesigns of our website, the implementation of Let's Talk, which has allowed us to engage in communication with our community in ways we hadn't done before. After 6 months of development, we are now rolling out, we're going to roll out tomorrow, the Ithaca City School District app. So if going into the app store, whichever device you're on, you can do a search for Ithaca Schools and download for free, so we're not using this for revenue generation just yet. You can download for free the Ithaca City School District app. And here's the first iteration, and this is the first, what will be, like our website, it will continuously get better, it will get better and better. I've learned a lot about development, so as my 5-year-old and 7-year-old have taught me, I need to learn how to code. So I'm going to try to walk you through what we've been able to develop. It took me 6 months, but it took them 6 hours to do, but that's another story. When downloading the app, you can customize it to meet your own individual needs, but some cool things about it, the news stories, as we publish new news stories now, and typically that was going to our website, and folks want, if our website wasn't your homepage, you wouldn't know about our new news stories. Now we have the capabilities to push information out to your cell phone. So you'll get the same notification you get for your Facebook and your tweets on your cell phone about the Ithaca City School District, if you so choose. But news stories are here, and for example, if you click on the most recent joint statement with ICSD and ITA, you'll get that. It's a pretty user-friendly feel here. It looks good. I'm going through it very quickly. We'll do a longer tutorial and a video online as well. You have access to Let's Talk right there at your fingertips to provide information about, provide feedback and ask questions about anything from the academic calendar, which we got many, to any other topic. Lunch menus, which is something that our community has been asking for more access to. Right now it's linked right to our website. We're working on the interface a bit so it'll quickly display your child's lunch menu based on which school they're in. That's in development right now, but right now you can get right to the links. And there are other things here, but another key link here I want folks to know about is this settings app. So here you can go in and you can click which schools you want to receive push notification for. Right now I have them all clicked because I want to hear about everything, but if you just want to hear about Bell Sherman, you would go in and you would click just Bell Sherman or just the district, except just like a typical app, but this is customized for the Ithaca City School District. And there's our YouTube channel, which we're populating again with cool videos about everything from our instructional things to our Board of Education meetings are archived here. So an easy to navigate interface for all of our school district YouTube videos and board meetings. So there's a lot here. I'm just rolling it out tonight briefly to let folks know to go in and download it now while it's still free. And please go in and click to get push notification for your child and the school of interest, and definitely click to get notification from the school district. And we hope that things like snow days and other major announcements, we can push that information to your smartphones or tablets as well. So two things, Ms. Andrew, that I wanted to roll out here first, and we look for press releases and more information to go out tomorrow.
Appreciate that, Dr. Brown.
Yeah, like the commercial.
You're going to charge taxpayers for that? I'm just trying to wrap my heads around that. As we roll into the...
In fact, you want people to go in and download today.
Right, right. As we roll into the budget, Dr. Brown. So thank you, Dr. Brown. Outstanding. And Dr. Brown, you're going to roll into the budget, correct?
Yes, we will. And I'm going to invite Matt Berber to the table and the rest of my team up close because I anticipate questions that will all be needed.
Closer. They seem to be near the door, Dr. Brown.
I can see you.
We, meaning the administration and the district, have been working on a budget for quite a while, Dr. Brown.
Yes.
Like all year, right?
And I think our presentation this evening will represent that or reflect that. This has been a year-round budgeting process. Much information has been shared about where we are with regards to our fund balance, particular instructional initiatives tonight. It's just an overview. We have the budget documents that we're going to share with the board tonight, and we're going to take questions. So I'm simply going to talk right now about our approach to developing the budget, tax levy and tax rate information. And Mr. Grant, you know I'm going to call on you to explain the tax rate versus levy as we do every year for the last 6 years. And we're going to also talk about some other things here as well. But as we have sought to this continuous improvement process and year-round budget process, it has been about our mission and vision. I looked at all the previous budget presentations of the last 6 years, and each one of them have this slide where we talk about our vision, mission, and how our funding request and the way we allocate funds is representing our mission and vision. And I don't have the slide about our achievement numbers here now because, quite frankly, we're working on a new baseline, but the remarkable gains we've had in our school district with regards to achievement metrics is amazing. And again, we are starting with a new baseline as we're entering into the conversation with the board around new metrics and priorities. But again, we are building a budget that meets the needs of the district, the mission and the vision. So we're proposing tonight a budget of $124,689,000. And Rob, I'm waiting for you to comment on the fact that you have three zeros at the end for the first time.
I did that a few meetings.
We rounded that off this time. But and you'll see where our budget has come from since 2014 to 15. This is representing a 4.7% increase year to year. We're going to talk about why that is in just a few moments. But $124 million. What that looks like as far as the tax levy, and we're going to talk about the tax rate in a second. You'll see that last year, where we had to override the tax cap, it was 8.9% tax levy increase. This year, we're proposing a 2.16, and that's to the tax cap, correct, Matt?
That's correct.
A 2.1. Going back into the 2% world, which the board has tasked us to be in. Tax rate, we anticipate the tax rate going down for the second consecutive year. And this year, down 1.1%, which looks like a tax rate. I may need to change the size of this slide. We used to talk about tax rate increases. Now we're talking about tax rate decreases. So, Mr. Grange, you're up. The difference between the tax levy and the tax rate that you just
talked about. Tax levy is the number of dollars we raise, and that's what people will vote on. We'll be asking people to vote on the levy, the total, and that becomes the uppermost number of dollars that we can expend next year. Voters approve it, and that's as far as we can go. That was the 124 number. The tax rate is how each individual's tax bill is calculated. That's the number of dollars per thousand in your assessment that you pay. And so I saw the numbers about a 20 cent per thousand reduction from where it is now. So if your assessment didn't change, you're going to go down 1.1%. If your assessment changed, I can't calculate it. But for all those for whom their assessment stayed steady, your tax will go down. The amount you pay, the rate goes down for everybody. If your assessment stayed the same, then you're going to go down 1.1%.
As an example, and this is a slide we use every year. For on a $100,000 house, the tax will decrease $13.65. On a $200,000 house, around $33, and $300,000, $52, and so on. So it gives you a sense of how your tax bill will be less this year if the assessment did not change.
Well, I see. You've got the, you say, with a star exemption and without increased assessment.
So I've sat here, and we've shared this slide. This is the seventh time, and that number has been high. Their taxes have gone up $80 and $90 on these priced homes. So in some ways, I'm happy that I'm happy that we're showing a decrease to one's tax bill, while at the same time maintaining programs and having these highlights, which we're going to speak to. You know, so we have we talk about the increase in the budget from year to year, the 4.7 increase in year to year. I think we need to be happy. At this time last year, we were negotiating three out of five contracts with our bargaining units. We entered into the school year with all of our contracts settled. And those contracts you're seeing represented in this this budget, this proposal, where we've settled those contracts with our ITA, our principals and directors, and our other bargaining units. More E&L support. Ms. Cole has been here to talk about our approach to being more inclusive and more equitable with our services for our E&L students. And we are going to provide those services in every school building next year. And that's going to come with an additional, how many FTE? Two?
Three.
Three FTEs. So we're going to, three FTE is going to allow us to have a much better program for our young people. The additional pre-K classroom, we've talked much about that. We're working on to incrementally improve and offer more services at the pre-K level, and we're looking to do a combination classroom next year. And co-curricular support. Every year there's rumors out there about us slashing co-curricular support, and every year we seem to increase our support for co-curricular activities, even in the face of significant fiscal constraints. This board, this community has shown and proven that they support our co-curricular programs because they increase achievement. We will do that yet again. We've added additional sport athletic programs this school year. Those programs we will continue if this budget is approved in next year. This type of a performance, our arts and music program will get additional support, not less support. So for any folks who are out there hearing that we're slashing, I heard this week that we're cutting those budgets in half. That's just not true. We've enhanced those programs every year, and this budget will do that yet again. Some key dates. The Teletown Hall will be coming up on May 8th. The Teletown Hall we do every year is coming up on May 8th. The budget hearing will happen also on May 8th. So we'll do the budget hearing on May 8th first, and then we'll go into the Teletown Hall conversation where we dial thousands of homes, and we engage in a discussion about how we allocate resources. And on May 16th will be the budget vote and the board elections. And I am personally happy to be here that we have three incumbents who are gathering signatures and seeking re-election to the Board of Education, and any other person in our community who's wishing to volunteer 30 and 40 hours per week are welcome to do so. But the election will take place on May the 16th. So I'm going to ask Amanda to speak to the four different propositions that will be on the ballot this year. Sometimes this slide can be sometimes confusing. So Amanda.
Sure. So the first proposition is pretty predictable, right? It's the budget amount. And so again, Dr. Brown showed that we have a budget of just over $124 million. And essentially, you're allowing us to spend up to that and no more. And so that sort of gives us the parameters under which we can create our operations. And we've gone through the budget many, many times. Obviously, we try to build in the actual operations, the cost of doing business. We also try to put in a little bit of funds there for the almost potentially unknowns, those things that are in special education and facilities that we know every year we sort of need to build in some available funds that maybe aren't exactly anticipated, but we know that we're most likely going to spend them. And then finally, also some other room there for the ability to still meet and address needs as we see fit. So we feel that this budget, we're confident this budget will cover all those aspects of operations. Proposition number two is, again, very predictable. Those of you that have gone out to vote before, you often will see. We have a very active capital reserve. We use it and monitor it. Every year we try to put funds into the capital reserve line so that we can then expend them to continue to replace our buses on average in every 10-year replacement cycle. And we also do some small capital improvement projects. Most likely, especially with this year, it'll be some asphalt work at two buildings, LACS and at Caroline, and then to be able to get some building aid back on that work that happens outside of the school building. We're also doing a little bit of work inside. It's mainly around doors, making sure that they're a little bit more accessible, not so heavy, and ensuring that, again, we have some you know, better facilities. This is small amounts of money in terms of the capital work compared to what we would go out for a bond. This is not a bond. This is using reserves that we already have in place.
Existing money, exactly.
Thank you, Brad. So to continue that work in terms of purchasing our buses and doing some small capital work, the capital reserve that we currently have has limitations to it. When we establish a capital reserve, it has a certain limit. That's why I said that we manage it very well. And it has, you know, a timeliness to it because we typically spend that every year from that reserve. So we're establishing a new capital reserve. It'll have a different year. It's established, obviously, for the 2018 school year. And that will give us the opportunity, again, to have a reserve where we, if we end the year to the good, we'll be able to put funds into that with a purpose. And again, to buy buses and to do capital projects. And then finally, Proposition 4 is an easement that has been talked about now, I think, for about 2 or 3 years. There is a parcel in Cuba Heights that is near the school building that actually has some sewer lines that we would like to be able to give them an easement for. And that will be outlined in that proposition. And that requires a vote for us to be able to give easement to property that is affiliated with the district. We must be able to go to the voters for that. So.
And Amanda, this is not a new encroachment on district property. It actually has been there for a long, long time.
1930s.
Right.
So it's a pre-existing line that is an issue.
And essentially, this will allow it moves on with each owner, so that it's no longer that you have to come to this school district every single time. Is that correct?
That's correct. So currently, the property interest is a license in that right of way for the sewer line. The way the easement is currently drafted, the easement itself would terminate at the time the sewer line is extinguished. So, but as Amanda said, it would continue on to subsequent owners until it is extinguished.
So
is that it, Dr. Brown? I mean,
that's it. Right now, Amanda has the document, and you have the document as well. We are here to answer any questions you may have. We can provide additional information between now and next meeting. So we are here to serve the will of the board, as always.
And I think, well, you had the calendar up, and I think it should be noted that in order to have a budget hearing and in a town hall, we need to adopt a budget ourselves. So our budget vote is likely going to be our next board meeting, is it not?
Yes, we hope so.
So
it needs to be in the state.
It could be tonight, or it could be April 24th.
So this is an opportunity to ask questions and explanations. Okay, the New York State, right, adopted their budget.
Piece, what changed with the budget?
Right.
So as you all know, and you know, I think we do a good job of talking about this every year in terms of the process by which we follow that's guided by the state. We get initial state aid runs in January, and then when the state adopts their budget, those typically have changes to it. So the state aid runs then get resent to districts. We received ours just about a week ago. Essentially, we received a little bit more foundation aid, not much, just a little bit. We received a bit more public and private excess cost aid. And we got a bit more in our software and library and textbook aid. So all of those increases totaled an additional $341,994. So it's just shy of the $400,000 mark, which a lot of schools saw. What we did in terms of the revenue, because we've talked so much about fund balance, is I increased the revenue in those state aid lines. We also reevaluated BOCES, and I think that we probably underestimated a little bit. I'm always conservative, so I increased that line a little bit as well. And therefore, we don't have to take the full $4 million for a designated fund balance. I actually feel that in addition to the $2 million that we use every single year, I think we need an additional $1.33 million. So then that way, that sort of balances that out. So increased state aid revenue, and then we don't have to go to our fund balance.
Can you drop that?
Yeah, so I actually, the revenue projection, I think I've already shared with Jen, we probably didn't go live with it yet, but she's got that ready in queue, and so we can put that tonight so that you can see it.
Great, thank you.
Okay.
All right, so folks that are listening and those in the room understand when we receive more money from the state than perhaps we estimated. We did not change our spending projections for next year. Our basic budget, really, you had set that upper amount.
That's right.
And that we didn't change our upper amount to spend another $380,000. Yeah. It goes back into really the revenue flow and where we're taking money within that budget.
That's right.
You're still confident in that budget number.
Yes.
And that's up 4.7%. And you might want to just talk a little bit if you want to just flip back to the growth chart.
Yeah, how you flatten that back out next year.
Just talk a little bit. You know, you can see, 1% increase and 3.5, and talk a little bit about 4.7, mm-hmm. and probably integrating the contracts that
Absolutely.
We settled. And mm-hmm. what happens from here?
Sure.
Because, go ahead.
So, on average, we try to calculate it, to sort of show growth from one year to the next. Probably in total, our contract settlements, I don't want to say it hit the budget because that sounds negative. We actually, we negotiate these things, right? So it really, in total, was about $4 million of all the contracts for all the bargaining units. And many of them actually are showing up as a multi-year because when we develop the budget number, it may not have actually shown the amount of money that current year we would have settled for, and then the next year. And so this is part of this is also catching up to some of the settlements that we negotiated, and that's normal business. The unique thing about last year was that there were a number of contracts being settled all at once. I think Bob, Matt, myself, Dr. Brown, we were in negotiations rooms sometimes 3 or 4 days out of the week with different groups because it just happened to be that the timing all fell that those contracts were coming to a close or reopening soon, and so we wanted to ensure that we got that done. So that really is the bulk of the reason why you sort of see the progression of that line going at a little bit higher of an angle than it was before. In moving forward, we always watch that. We always chart that. We actually have predictability right now. We're in negotiations with the Employees Association, all the others, and you'll be going in with Substitutes Union, but all the others are settled now for the next at least 2 years. And so we'll be going back to the table, or maybe 1 year with the teachers. So we'll be going back to the table then next year. And so we, again, plan for that growth in terms of salaries and benefits as we develop the budget. And so, we put budgeted amounts in as estimations, but obviously things happen at the negotiation table. Typically, good work at the negotiation table is everybody gives a little bit. So we budget some funds and people at the negotiation table also, make changes to what they have. And so therefore, with that balance, we landed at about a $4 million increase.
Okay, so just to simplify all of this, this increase here is primarily instructional salary.
Absolutely.
Okay, and that was, we might remember that our teachers were very unhappy with salary. They were unhappy with starting salary. There were huge numbers in the rooms. There were protests down on Route 13, and we responded to that by putting a significant amount of money into teachers' salaries while staying under the tax cap for our taxpayers, because that has significant, going over the tax cap has consequences for taxpayers not getting their wonderful rebate checks from New York State. So yes, it's an increase, but we are remaining under the tax cap and we've made our teachers happier.
and the tax bill is so less for most people.
And tax, yeah, not for me.
I
that's all right. That's okay. But yes, and the tax bill will go down. It will not go down as much as if we hadn't given teachers those raises, but we felt that that was fair, and I personally felt that it was fair.
Others.
Just on that same topic a little bit, as I understand it, though, it's steeper this year, but by next year it will probably flatten out somewhat because we won't be in that catch-up.
Right, because we won't have that. We won't have the significance of those settlements all happening at one time. But there's a predictability. I mean, there's cost of living that go up, or the cost of doing business, right, goes up. And so we know if you know all of our contracts are online. You can see actually, you know, with the bargaining units, you know, what their increases will be next year. That's incorporated in the budget. And so there's a predictability to sort of the, you know, how that line is going up. It's not that it's going to stay flat, but it definitely there will be an increase because the contracts were settled for multiple years. But it won't be as significant as we're seeing this year.
Good.
Maybe it would be helpful for people at home an explanation again of how is 4.7 underneath the tax cap, which is 2%.
Okay, so the 4.7 is the budget-to-budget increase,
right.
And due to increases in all of our revenue lines, which includes the tax levy,
mm-hmm.
The tax levy is really where that sort of misnomer of the 2% lives.
Right.
A budget can increase due to growth in other areas of revenue. So we just talked about the state aid increased. So that gave us a boost in our revenue from last year to this year. And so state aid, just put my revenue sheet down. Let's see, the state aid is increasing 4.8% from last year to this year.
Okay.
So again, that actually went up at a higher percentage rate. That equals about 1.4 million of additional revenue that we had from last year to this year. Other revenues really sort of stayed the same. The property tax cap is 2.16%. Again, over the proverbial 2%, but that's again a misnomer. We have a calculation that we use. We are able to take the prior year levy, current year levy to calculate. We put in anything that we believe or that we could show are exclusions, and they're usually capital related. So any of our debt service, the energy performance contract work, the purchasing actually not our buses. We actually have to take out state aid. We have to remove the state aid from that. That gives us our total exclusion, and we landed per the formula at 2.16%. And then we obviously are using fund balance, but we've analyzed that. We feel confident that we're not going to be taxing our fund balance and our reserves by utilizing some of that to also balance the budget. And so that's where sort of that in totality gives us that 4% increase.
And we also have to remember that we're one of the few communities in upstate New York where they're actually building buildings. And mm-hmm. and it's not Cornell doing it, it's actually taxable property. And hopefully they don't have a pilot or a tax abatement. And
right.
We're always very happy when we're building buildings for profit and they have to pay taxes. And our assessed value within our district has gone up
3% this year.
Mm-hmm.
Gone up 3%.
Yeah.
So we get a raise, basically.
That's right. That's right. It's really interesting because it helps us with the rate. It helps the taxpayer themselves.
To the rate.
It's interesting that in the tax cap calculation, our growth ratio, it doesn't really impact that much, although we're growing. So it's sort of an interesting phenomenon. But we're getting it in a really great place, which is at the taxpayers.
Right.
Just for future reference, I see we're starting to pay the lease and the EPC.
That's right.
You know, just at some point in the future, I'd like to get the data on whether it really worked or not.
Sure. At Finance and Facilities, we'll be talking a little bit more. I think the last project of the EPC is coming up. The Energy Performance Contract, or the EPC, that's been ongoing. Many of you who have been tuning into board meetings have been, you know, were patiently waiting for that to get approved at the state level. And when it did, we you know, got out there and did all the work in terms of our building envelope, creating efficiencies with that, our lighting, and a lot of the heating controls in all of our buildings. And so obviously the way an energy performance contract works is that, yes, we have to pay for it. We get debt service to do that. It's actually a lease, and it's a very unique, it's different from a bond that we pay off over the course of time. And the great part about an energy performance contract is that when you look at both the savings added to actually all of the incentives and the state aid that we generate, it actually comes to a net zero. And the companies that are behind these energy performance contracts that do the work, they actually sign a commitment to the district saying that if you do not achieve those savings that we promised you over the course of, I think it's the 18 years, that we will provide you with the difference. And so it's a great way for districts to be able to do work that's sort of not glamorous, but imperative for our personal comfort, right? At a no cost. So you'll see a cost there, but you'll also see a savings in the facilities lines. What we decided to do, especially around some of the facilities issues that are needed to be addressed, and there are a lot of aesthetics around, you know, carpeting and tiling and painting and chipping and cracking and all that. We tried to create a reserve within the facilities budget line that took a little bit of that savings and put it back into the budget to be able to be utilized for those situations. So we're asking for the public to support about $100,000 in that area of the budget to take those savings and convert it.
Thank you.
To that point, Amanda, the EPC and the capital reserve for bus purchases. We started the bus purchases, pulling that out of the operating budget years ago, and through the establishment of the capital reserves. But it was an effort to try to remove costs from the budget that we could and move it to capital, which we can't spend on salaries and programming and teachers in the classroom, and come up with a creative way to spend that money. The EPC is a way to replace our fixtures, get more efficient with our utilities. We'd rather pay teachers than pay an electric bill. I mean, so however we can do that. So it's really been a few moves over the years to try to keep as much of the budget in the classroom rather than buying physical stuff. So sounds like it's hopefully the EPC will work, but we've got a guaranteed contract, so it's all good.
It's kind of big numbers, so I know this, so I'm just curious to be able to see the results.
That's right.
But it adds to our debt service line.
Yes, it does.
So see a significant increase in debt service this year, and then it will definitely decrease next year. It also, though, is dependent on the decisions that are made around the BOCES capital project, because that will go into our debt service line as well. So we might not see a significant of a decrease in 1 year or the next if that is supported.
So the plan is to put a resolution on in 2 weeks, and we're going to have further discussion in finance. Is that the
We have had special board meetings in the past to hash out the budget and go through item by item. It's really up to the board how you wish to go forward.
I'll take this opportunity to remind the folks watching at home, we've spent 45 minutes having a conversation about the budget tonight, but that's on top of hundreds of hours this board has put into developing this budget. Our process has not shifted since my first year doing this. Thanks to the board. The Finance and Facility Committee meetings, at every board meeting, we're talking about budget and implications. So we built this over the course of the year. And secondly, in anticipation of the question you ask me every year this time, from my perspective, this budget meets the needs of our alumnus. I'm proud of this budget as a community member and as a parent first. I feel like it will do what it needs to do for my child and every other child in our school district. And that's a good thing to say. And I'm proud to say that in our community. When other communities aren't able to say that right now. So thank you, board, thank you, community.
Alder, go ahead.
So this year, without having conversations about having loose teachers, without having conversations about the potential to cut back on student-centered programs. When the teachers were here last year, several of them said, let's just say they implied that life would be greener in other pastures. Now we have a chance to start building our thing back. I'm just curious, do you have any information about what's happening to some of our neighbors in terms of how they're faring? I'm not trying to cast aspersions on anybody, but it hadn't come up for me to really think about it until the teachers presented it to us last year that they would might happily go skipping down the street to Auburn or Elmira or someplace else. So now they have me curious.
I mean, I'll speak to it, and I'll do my best not to talk much about my colleagues, but just read the newspapers tomorrow about the conversations that are going to be occurring at board meetings tonight. And pay special attention to what's happening in Auburn. They're likely to roll out a budget of about $73, $74 million for 4,200 students. And that's going to be down probably a significant number of staff, and that's been year to year. So another small city nearby, the closest one to us, is having a very, very different conversation tonight than we're having here. And I met with their superintendent, assistant superintendent, and high school principal just last week. And yeah, it's an interesting conversation. That's just one. But again, look at the other conversations that are going to be coming tonight in the paper, in this book clips tomorrow.
And you know, it needs to be said every year. We do this in an environment where an incredible amount of our property in this area is not taxable because of our friends up the hill. And our property tax owners, our homeowners, take up the slack. So 70% of our budget comes from folks like us around this table writing checks. I think once people really get to see how our machine works behind the curtain, our matrix, I would like to think they'd become more appreciative of how we're managing this. We're all happy that we got the teachers to a decent starting salary, even with a bachelor's degree, a couple of thousand more with a master's. I'm happy with how things are going. We survived. Now hopefully we can start building ourselves back up.
Can I make Matt answer questions?
Hopefully.
So Matt, we typically talk about teachers in reserve and flexibility at the elementary level, and you always fill us in on what maybe are we adding? Are we what's happening? Again, we always like to come back to what's happening in the classroom. So.
Sure. The teacher increases that we are budgeting for this upcoming year, besides the ones that are on that slide. We're budgeting for 3 FTE at the elementary level. These 3 FTE, we have a fifth grade. Roughly, almost every single one of our classes has 400 students, you know, across the district. Our fifth grade group, for whatever reason, has 330. So they are graduating into middle school, and they will be replaced by, most likely, a kindergarten class of 400 students. So we're adding 3 elementary teachers to offset that class size issue in a few of our schools. And then we also are putting 3 FTE in reserve, just for kind of, you know, the unexpected class size or offering issues that come up during the school year. We are not foreseeing a need to increase FTE at any of our secondary schools. We right now are just seeing it at the elementary level. So there's always sometimes small adjustments at the secondary level where we add a teacher adds a class to their schedule, or, you know, like small portions of FTE that we may need to add once the high school schedule gets set. But our biggest addition, and we have held steady with the number of elementary teachers for my whole time being here, so we feel we're going to need to add 3, and so we put that in the budget, and we're planning. One will probably be at Fall Creek, Mike's sitting over there, one will most likely be at South Hill, and one will be at Northeast, possibly with an additional, like, second one at Northeast, because their class sizes have grown pretty large in a few grades. So if we do add that fourth one in Northeast, we'll be looking at some of our smallest class sizes in schools and probably moving one of those FTE to Northeast to offset. We may try to make those decisions late in the school year, so we're looking at the best numbers we possibly can. But it's something we spend a lot of time looking at this to make sure we're just not growing for no reason. And at the elementary level, we've really held firm.
Since Ithaca High is here and they're not asking questions, so what about Ithaca High School? Jason has not had my ear. We haven't really had Jason come and talk about the Ithaca High and what they need next or what is critical at Ithaca High. Any insight on what we're doing at Ithaca High? Anything different? We're just doing the same.
Well, the first year, the many years, we are reducing staff. So that's the first highlight. We've had reduced staff in there over the previous years. So this year, we don't anticipate any of that.
Well, one thing we did do 2 years ago, though, we increased FTE there by about 1.2, and that was a class size reduction across some English and social studies classes primarily. And that was an investment, you know, you all made in shifting some things at the high school that the high school administration and some department leaders and chairs really pushed hard for. With that addition, though, a couple of years ago, things have held steady. We always have the need to add a class in some different areas and add it to, you know, either hire a part-time teacher or add a class to a teacher's FTE. And we, you know, it's fairly predictable that will happen again, but we don't see any massive or, you know, large staffing increases at the high school right now.
Graduation coaches, do we have two?
It's at 1.0 now. We were at 2, and we made that reduction a few years ago. This budget does not include the additional graduation coach coming back. That hasn't been a recommendation at this point.
Just ask.
Yeah, no, thanks for asking that question.
Other questions? Don't let me ask.
The class size, just looking at those cohorts. So your middle school population is going to go down by about 45.
Yeah, I spoke at length with both our middle school principals. The way middle school teaming works, a reduction in student size, it's really hard to just sort of pull an FTE out. The teams are constituted in a way where it's difficult to do that. And so,
and it's a one-year issue.
Yeah, we decided to hold steady with that.
Because the cohort behind
is
always another 7.
Yeah.
I do want to say Betty Coyle is the one member of our team that's missing. She is watching from home, and so she has some family things going on. And so she texted us to let us know that, to answer your question, Rob, that at the high school there will also be PD money absolutely contributed toward interdisciplinary work for the teams there.
Very good. I didn't know anybody actually listened.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of chatter. And if I could take this opportunity, Rob, to send your questions in, use the ICSD BOE hashtag, or just tweet at us. So we're getting a lot of people. Some folks are downloading the app already and asking questions about the work.
And you need to get to charge.
Other questions?
Last question from me for now. How's that?
Right.
Co-curricular support, I think you mentioned increasing, or at least, you know, showing our appreciation for that. What's that look like so far?
And most of it is for athletics. We added alpine skiing and indoor track. Mm-hmm. Those are pilot programs in this current year. We're going to continue those for next year. So the coaching, uniforms, and all things associated with those two sports are going to continue. There were also some equipment lines that we had reduced 3 years ago that we brought back up to their 2013-2014 levels. That was big for uniform replacement and equipment purchases. The study hall, the academic support that we provided this year, which was the first time, that from my perspective, allow for more and more of our young people to participate and stay eligible. Mm-hmm. We're going to continue that next year, and that costs around $20,000. So the enhancements that we made in this current year, this budget reflects us continuing to build it into next year.
I saw those unions. The basketball team made it to stack champions, right? Went to regionals. I saw the team they played against with some pretty snazzy outfits there, peeling them off. and looked at our kids like,
But they didn't come with a black buck, though.
That is true. Yeah. That is true. They didn't have fancy
bucks. You know? Cloth is always an issue, Dr. Brown. Cloth is always an issue. Other questions, comments? Matt's still all over it. I appreciate that, Matt. That was just a test. It was good. Matt's all over.
So next meeting, we'll be having more conversation, and then at the next board meeting, we hope a recommendation and an approval.
So we're good? We're good on... So we'll talk more next Tuesday at the Finance Committee, which is really a segment of the whole board, and the whole board may show up, and it's a public meeting.
It's very popular.
Not next week, though. The whole board's not showing up.
Board's not showing up, but anyone in the public can show up if they want. Same room at, 5:30? Yes. 5:30 on Tuesday. That's when the board meets in various capacities on the off Tuesday. That's where we get a lot of work done. And Dr. Brown, so we're good on the budget. It went away, so we're not going to talk about budget anymore. Okay.
You're not going to leave the
text room or something?
I'll put it back up later.
Okay.
Dramatic effect.
So thanks, everyone. We're going to move on to...
I'm going to table the resolution authorizing a commencement of a special, et cetera, as presented here.
Okay.
To table that until the next meeting.
Second.
I guess all in favor, right? Yes, right.
Moira.
Do we understand?
Yeah.
Moira,
oh,
second.
Yes.
Right, all in favor? That's everyone.
I'll move the resolution adopting the property tax report card.
Second.
Way to sneak that in, Chris. Very good.
There's a slow pause there. So.
Everybody's saying, a report card? Are we being graded?
We're being graded.
Are we being graded?
Yeah,
I see it here. Does everyone know what they're voting on?
We're reporting our tax rate and our levy rate.
And this can be modified if changes are made, but this is a deadline for the state that we need to be able to get a vote on by a certain point in time. And so it feels a little bit odd that this is coming before the budget, but this would be the opportunity that we would have as a full board to be able to vote on this. And so again, modifications can happen. This will also be in the budget mailer. So this is sort of that back page of the budget mailer that folks get in, and it sort of shows what we did last year.
Looks like this.
What we did this year. It talks about our reserves and fund balance. It talks about our student count. We always go back and forth with the student count. I double-checked this year. It's essentially, it's the public school enrollment, and it is any student that essentially the budget supports. So those would include then new roots. That would include our BOCs, young people, and so the BOCs. So we want to ensure that we got that right. So the Vanderbilt meeting again was exceptionally helpful, as always, pulling this together
to make
sure that we got the right numbers. And great. Angela Jordan as well.
Was this moved?
Yes, I second.
Oh, that's right, Chris. That's the one you snuck in. All right. Any questions?
I assume the number two.
Move seconded. All in favor? That is everyone. And we'll move on to a tabled item, I believe. Is this tabled from last meeting?
Yep.
The academic calendar. And you've got input, Dr. Brown, correct?
Yes, we do.
Most of the input that we got about the calendar was about spring break. Basically, just not being at the right time, either being too early, it's the last week of March, or too close to February break, not when Cornell break is, or too far away from the end of the year. I think that sort of summarizes the three different kinds of
feedback
we got.
Also, that a week later would be better for Passover. That was another comment that we got.
This year, maybe, or next year, maybe, but it's, anyway, so, yeah, it moves, yes.
Right, right, but I mean, this for next year's calendar, a week later would be better for Passover.
Right.
So, we really feel that we need to be as in line as possible with the BOCES calendar. BOCES adopts their calendar first, and then we were getting input from ITA and just working as a team to put together the calendar. The reason why it's important for us to line up with BOCES spring break is we have 64 students at the high school who either do AM or PM shifts at BOCES. We also have students in Turning Point class at BOCES. We have students in Lighthouse and Little Lighthouse. We have students at the Regional Alternative School. If you add all those kids up, it's another 60, 70, 80 kids. So we have about 150 students that it's probably, not probably, it's very important that we have as aligned a calendar as possible with the BOCES calendar. So if we have a full different week for spring break that some of BOCES is those kids are having 2 weeks of interrupted instruction, essentially, because either we're off and not providing transportation or BOCES is closed. And when they're not aligned, it's basically...
So they lose 10 days of instruction.
Yes. So, you know, I feel like I'm in this position every year with the calendar where, you know, no one's happy, but our recommendation is, despite the feedback, to move forward. I think a process thing, and Brad, you got me thinking about it last board meeting, because at the last board meeting you said, let's just vote. Are you going to change it? I think maybe, you know, I won't be here for this part next year, but maybe we just sort of try to get feedback, like, you know, in January, just general feedback from the community in January that we try to take to the BOCES process, you know, to inform it. Because it's, you know, when BOCES makes their calendar, We always vary off the BOCES calendar maybe a couple of days. You know, we may have another PLC day that they don't have, or they may have a PLC day that we don't have. Sometimes our February break is not fully aligned, but the spring break, you know, as Brad said, it's we're interrupting 10 days if we're not in line with their spring break. So that's my recommendation for the calendar.
Thanks, Matt. Any other questions? Comments?
I'll move adoption of
the
calendar as presented.
Second.
Second by Pat. I wasn't sure we were going to get one. Okay. Thank you, Pat. Any other questions? We will vote. All in favor? I guess that is everyone. That's not everyone. Those opposed? Nicole. Thank you, Nicole. We voted on the calendar in the past and voted on it again, so perhaps we will revisit. But for now, we have adopted the calendar for next year. And looks like one more item. Yeah, this is it's a resolution, but let's talk about this resolution and the reasons therein, and if we could.
Amanda, you want to speak briefly? This is the BOCES capital plan in the resolution.
Right. So, you know, the BOCES, obviously we send students to BOCES for a number of reasons, right? We have we send students to BOCES for special education services. We send BOCES students for a regional alternative high school and middle school. They have a career in tech program. We have professional development services through them, even all the way through other services that are not so glamorous, like waste removal and energy management. And so, you know, the BOCES provides Ithaca with a tremendous amount of services. They came here you know, a few weeks ago, gave a much better overview of this capital project than I ever could. But essentially what they're asking for is that they also need to take care of their facilities. And a BOCES doesn't have a budget of its own that they can go to a taxpayer for their own levy. They need to use the school districts that are part of their Board of Cooperative Services and utilize the taxpayers that live in those districts on the Board of Eds that represent those taxpayers and be able to support any projects that they would do on their campus. And so they had three different capital projects that they began with last calendar year.
I think they've received a lot of feedback from districts, and they settled on the least expensive of the three. I believe it's a total of an $8 million project. Ithaca, being the largest district of the BOCES, shoulders the largest burden of that capital project. And so essentially the resolution is asking for Ithaca to support that capital project at, let's say, $3.3 million. Now, obviously, any capital work that we do, whether it's ours or at the BOCES, we do get aid back. We get BOCES aid back, not building aid, but BOCES aid back on about 83% of the costs that would be of that $3.3 million, because there's a certain amount that is not aidable. It's actually administrative, and so you can't get aid back on that. So we would receive aid back on that monies. We could do it in a combination. We could secure debt so that, therefore, it doesn't affect our cash flow. We have to pay interest on that debt, so there's a little bit more cost to that. We could look at our budget and see if there are ways that we could pay it other installments. We could look at the BOCES rebate and not take all that back as revenue and allow for that to be utilized to pay for the capital project. It's my understanding that the capital project is really not glamorous. It really is about the infrastructure and keeping the infrastructure whole. It's not creating classrooms. It's not creating a design that we would be in awe of. It really is about the behind the scenes, the operations itself. It's piping, buried electrical lines, and roofing on the buildings. So it's really falls into the categories of alteration and reconstruction.
Well, we talked about this at another point. You had kind of had a cost per year for about 10 years. Was that, and if I recall correctly, it was like $250,000?
It's going to be about $300,000 if we bond for this.
Yeah. So I did the costs. This is after aid, so I was able to sort of look at it in 3 years.
But in the first year, I've got to pay it. It's a reimbursement. Yeah. So what's the cost in the first year? Because there's zero aid.
That's right.
In the first year. Mm-hmm. And that's what hits the budget in the first year.
So that's right.
Okay, so what would that be?
So I have, without the, prior to the aid, I have $372,250 in year one. So that would time it up then you know, that would generate aid.
And then what you said was the following year we would get aid on 83% of it at our BOCES aid rate.
42%
of 83%.
Right, and then, but then there's also, so you multiply that, we get 83% of that 372,000. You multiply that by the aid ratio, and we also only pay of that 42% of that. So that's that first year, so 372. If I did the math,
that's our share.
That's the 53,000. And let me just take a peek here. And I vetted this with the BOCES. So let me just be sure.
That's right.
Year one. Component share. We're 42% of the cost. We get a 42% aid ratio. The bond percentage is 83%. We have a total of our total component share, our estimated total component share, is $3.37 million. Our estimated debt service, there is, assuming a 4% interest rate, is $4.5 million. So our estimated total component share after state aid is $2.9
million. Over 15 years.
And then the estimated component share after aid, a 15-year average, is just shy of $200,000 a year for 15 years.
Oh, so, okay, so $200,000 a year.
No, that's that's the unaided amount.
So it'll essentially cost us $3 million total.
Okay.
After all this.
So $370,000 in round numbers, $370,000 in year one.
$370,000.
Because we don't get any aid in year one. Mm-hmm. It's a reimbursement.
That's right.
And then it's $200,000 a year in the next 14 years.
If we
have 12. Unless you found another $3.3 million somewhere. I'm assuming we're going to borrow it.
Right.
And how would that affect the budget that was
so in your first, and that comes to the tax cap issue. So it would affect your first year budget of by $370,000. And
which is about a half
a little less than a half a percent. Call it 0.4%. About 0.4% of the levy. So that's been our issue with the tax cap, and Ann's done a lot of work on this legislatively, trying to get the exclusion of that, or the allowance of that in the tax cap.
Yeah.
So that in that first year, you could add it. So instead of a 2.16, we'd be at a 2.5.
Right. Mm-hmm. The first year.
Now the money's in. Now that debt service is in your base. The next year, you go back to whatever the 2.1, whatever it was. But you've been allowed that one time to put it back up. We're not allowed to do that. The things they excluded are BOCES capital and pilots from the calculation on the tax cap. And so for us, that means in year one, $370,000 has to come out of the general fund budget. So it's got to come from somewhere. And so it's going to come from program. And that's been the issue. Our assemblywoman's very aware of the issue. She thinks it's going to get resolved. I guess our friends at BOCES tell us we have to do this month. There's no... They have only one time a year window to submit a capital project?
That is what I was told. So this came up at the last BOCES meeting, which was on Friday. And they have been talking about the capital project and the need to undertake this since I have been the board rep. This is pure unglamorous infrastructure. Apparently, when the electrical wiring was put in up at the BOCES plant, whatever physical plant, back of the cables, they didn't sheath it in anything. There's just wires in the ground. There are problems with the plumbing. There are problems with the roofs, and they have wanted to do something since around 2008, when the bottom fell out of all kinds of school budgets, and they feel that this is long overdue. They don't have anything right now, as I understand it, that's not working, but something could come at any time, and their belief is that this is the most cost-effective and efficient and practical way to address the problem of an old, crumbling, badly installed infrastructure, and that if they do have an emergency, then that could be wildly more expensive and it could shut down services. And that this is bare bones necessary. They're not doing new classrooms. They're not changing the footprint. They are doing what they consider to be minimally necessary as good partners to keep all the programs that we use running. I have been telling them for 6 months that not being able to exclude it from the tax cap is problematic for us. I also tell them that I'm not one of the finance people, so this is about as far as I can go on this. Now, what I heard on Friday was that this has to be acted on now so that they can put all of the paperwork through to start construction next summer, and they said it won't affect this year's budget. We would budget it into next year's budget. Now, Amanda, you would have to tell me if that's true. That there would be no effect on this year's budget. Barbara Lifton has told them that the legislature will act on excluding BOCES capital projects from the tax cap in May or June when they return, and that it will be a separate item. It will not be just buried in the budget, and she believes it will pass. So I, of course, said, well, gee, can't you just hold things up and you know, wait until this is here? No, this has to go in April. Amanda, right,
so
you can...
This is the SED waiting time.
It's most likely.
This isn't that they have a one-time-a-year window. This is, they've got the same problem we all have, waiting in line at SED to get something approved.
So, Amanda, do you have any insight on whether we can wait a few months until this gets fixed? I told them that our finance committee would have a problem in taking this on faith that the New York State Legislature was going to do something good.
Right. And I want to go back to the beginning again, because I think, I just want to be clear, I have the numbers here now that I looked at the spreadsheet one more time. Pat, I think what they're speaking to about the impact in year one is relative to what I was saying about the 372,000 being the first year total cost for everybody. And so they actually have May, June, July, and August. They anticipate costs in 2017, A&E fees, architect and engineering fees, in the total amount of $372,250, probably to prep them and get ready to go for the state ed review process and all of that. So that $372,250 will hit us essentially, and that's where I was sort of doing that portion. $372,250 is the total amount. We make up about 42% of that. That would be our share.
So they're looking for $150,000 this year?
They're looking for $53,988 in year one. $53,988 in year one
from
us.
Design and development.
For architecture and engineer
How
fees.
How much is the A&E fees?
So it's ready, $372,250. You multiply that by 41.93%, right, which is our...
That's our Arwada.
Okay.
It's 156,000.
Only 83.2% of that is as aidable. So
yeah, but
this changes the whole thing. That's 156,000 in this coming year's budget.
No, it's $53,000 in this coming year because we also then we'll have to put it out and then we get
right.
The aid.
Thank you.
That's
right.
Thank
you.
I apologize. That's our disconnect.
I'm trying to deal with
yes.
cash. Coin of the realm.
With cash. That's right. So then it will cost us in total $53,000.
Oh,
you're
this
right.
Is
we're speaking the same.
Was.
We're speaking the same,
right.
But different years, fiscal years.
Right. Payment next year would be
$300,000.
The total amount.
Next year, this time we'd be budgeting.
Next year, then it jumps up.
That's
so it goes from in year one $372,000, and then the total for next year for year two in 2018 would be $2,746,358. That includes architecture and engineering, significant construction costs,
right.
And then obviously the reimbursable allowances
right.
that we're all used to.
Yeah, we have to borrow. We have to bond the money next year, right? Next
all right this is a change. This now I understand it's going to impact the 17-18 budget. I mean, if somebody wants to move it, we can move it. I'll vote against it, but I'd rather we sit on it until we know more. I'd like to see that schedule and understand better what my risks are with the legislature and the tax cap, because clearly I don't understand them. I didn't know there was a 17-18 impact.
This is my understanding that it's all architecture and engineering.
I understand, but we have
schedule.
To pay our share.
Yeah.
We have to pay our share if we go ahead.
I was told on Friday that it would not affect that we wouldn't be paying until the following year.
You just read it. I mean,
I understand. So it's taking me by surprise, also.
Exactly. So I assume you would vote no as well. So I'm
and
rather than bringing.
And this was dated January 26th. So unless they had newer information, this was we received.
They didn't give me. They didn't give us any information.
I guess what I'd like.
So, I just have a couple kind of clarifications. So, to your original question, they gave us the impression that it has to be done now so they can submit. And so, it's not an actual official deadline. Your view is that they're just trying to get in the queue. Is that correct?
Sure. They want to be in the queue.
It's just about being in the queue.
You have to declare a date at some point.
Okay.
If you're going to get this work ever started, we need a commitment from the district.
Okay.
So
right. But it's about the queue. The second thing is, I know this is going to sound really out there, but It sounds like one of the things they need to get into the queue is the kind of research and development money, the money that's like to make the plan. Is there any way to, if we don't have any resolution on the tax cap issue, is there ever a way they could break it off so we just do the first part, you know, like the plan so they can get them to...
They're not going to move ahead.
Okay, never mind.
They're not going to. That's very clear.
I think we have a choice. We can ignore this for another 2 months and see what the legislature does and then bring it up again, or we can bring it up tonight and vote on it. Now that we're learning new information that actually impacts the 17-18 budget, I'm less of a fan than I was before. So, and that means management. Where are you going to take the $150,000 from? Which teachers walk the plank over that?
That's not a decision I'm excited to make. I'm wishing Mr. Madison and folks were here tonight. This item is on the agenda, and they know that our board is having a tough time grappling with it, so I will reach out to them tomorrow.
Well, I think what you need to tell them is we don't have complete information. Yeah. We weren't given truthful information. If we were told there was no impact in 17-18, and now I'm being told there clearly is impact in 17-18, that wasn't telling me the truth. And that doesn't make me real happy. So I'd like to see a better schedule of what they want and when they need it from it.
Go ahead, Al.
I understand Brad's point clearly, but I need to go back to something else we were discussing for my own clarification. If we were to go through with this, I hear that we would then be on the $200,000 a year in debt service.
Yeah.
For
15
years. And because this is just basics for BOCES, the expectation clearly is that they'll come back next year, right, with another project.
That's their intention.
Built up their physical plant to what our needs are and their needs. So we would continue to add these fees, right?
These expenses.
And that's why we need this tax cap thing corrected. Mm-hmm. And if we vote yes tonight, we've got nobody else advocating with us because the project's going ahead, so they don't care whether Ithaca gets what they need or not.
This is the advocate right here.
Yeah, I understand that.
The entire county.
I understand that, but I think if we take no action, we might finally get the attention of some of the other component districts.
Understood.
I mean, Pat's been trying to communicate to them that this is an issue for us, and I think they've been ignoring it.
We don't want...
Because it's not an issue for them. They get 90% of their money from the state. It's not as big a deal.
And we don't want to certainly lose the sight of the fact that we have students at BOCES.
We understand.
And those buildings. And if one thing this board has tried to do is make sure that, you know, our facilities are upgraded, that we have, well, the roofs don't leak and everything works, and, you know, that... We've tried to continually fix things. I mean, I told the board a long time ago, you know, it's okay to fix things. And then they made me get on the board, but that's to try to figure out how to do that. But, you know, so they need to consistently fix the facilities, and the facilities need to be adequate for our students that go there every day.
But you know, we've been beating the drum that there's a problem with the BOCES tax cap exclusion, and we haven't been getting a lot of help.
At the state level.
No.
We haven't been getting a lot of help from the other component districts. Now maybe they'll be interested.
Right. It's not a question of that we don't value one segment of our students over another. It's just that there's deep dysfunction in BOCES governance, perhaps, at the state level, and it's convoluted, and it's not clear and how we should deal with these issues.
Well, the other problem is really the state issue, is that the exclusion that the Assembly had, and the Senate, they had all voted to exclude it from the tax cap, and the governor's office has never followed through because they'd said may instead of must. And so they said, okay, we won't bother.
Right.
So the fact is that it's been an issue for a while, and we've been working on it on the board for about a year now. So, and it's kind of the problem only, you only become aware of the problem when you look at the financial impact on the district. And once, unfortunately, if once it happens, then we're you can't just walk away from that financial commitment. So it's a kind of quandary.
Right. We're a big part of BOCES, so.
I understand.
Right, so we're going to have to figure this out, I suppose.
So we need to table this.
Yeah.
Well, I don't even want to table you.
Delay.
Oh, no, delay.
Because the table means it comes back up next meeting.
Right.
Well, I think we need to.
I want to kick this back to the officers to bring back when there's a resolution at the state level.
And we'll kick it back to finance to get us some more info.
Well, I think at the May meeting,
yeah.
I don't want to put it on this month's agenda, but at the May meeting, we should have a better
right.
description of what is going to be required of us when.
And Brian, if you recall, I mean, I was at the finance meeting, and BOCES at that point made a presentation over perhaps three different alternatives and
yes,
really
right.
didn't hear what their choice was until we saw a number and
right.
really not the justification for why that one or why not. You know,
right.
really the details were missing as far as I could tell.
Yep. If we do nothing tonight, does that impact your capacity to get the ball rolling?
Yes. No. Yes, it does.
But if I understand it, though, say we postpone it tonight and we wait for the additional information, they could, in theory, then submit it in June. It
right.
might
yeah.
still
they,
take.
They told me no. Tom Parsons, acting for Jeff Madison, told me no. If they don't put this in April, they can't do it. Now
they'll never do it.
They
never.
They can't do it. They can't start it next year.
I wasn't told April. I had May. I had that they needed to go to their BOCES board by May.
But that we needed something in April so that they could take it to their BOCES
board.
Board
in May.
That, and that everybody had to be on board.
Because they want to submit the application of final plans and specifications for the summer 2017.
They want to, yes.
They want to.
And state and department approval is February 2018.
And I want foundation aid fully funded.
Right.
Wishes, wants,
well, it, it sounds like arm twisting.
So
the analogy I use with Ahmed and Mira is their parents coming to them and saying, we need to rebuild the kitchen, but to do that, we have to tap into your allowance. And they both agree that that's not such a good plan.
BOCES has no way to fund
right.
capital improvements
right.
except for all the districts to pay for it.
Right. Right. They cannot.
And I am.
They can't borrow money. They can't tax.
Can I report that the board supports the need for capital improvements at BOCES?
Yes.
Absolutely.
What
yes.
I've tried to say is that we're not against BOCES, but we don't have the capacity to absorb this into their budget without being able to exclude it from the tax cap, just like we exclude our own capital improvements from
exactly.
the tax cap.
Right.
Exactly.
I have been saying this every month, and
apparently they're not hearing it.
But well, there's also lack of clarity on how it impacts this year and next year.
Well, yeah,
we need to know exactly.
I think BOCES has heard me. Jeff Madison has heard me. Tom Parsons has heard me. Charles Borgognoni from New York State School Boards Association has heard me. They have both said it's all because of Andrew Cuomo refusing to act on this. It is Cuomo's inaction at the state level that's causing this, and they believe, and Barbara Lipton believes, that the legislature will pull this out into the open in May and June instead of letting Andrew Cuomo hide it under a rock like a secret that he can then, oh God, he's going to come and get me. that he can then, you know, wheel and deal favors for, that they will just have to put it out there, and Tom Parsons was saying he feels that it will be so glaringly obvious that Cuomo won't be able to stop it.
Well,
they said some other things about Cuomo, but they're not on tape.
Because I know, you know, we know there's one other BOE that went ahead as a capital project on the assumption that that exclusion was in place, got a big surprise.
Well, I brought that up.
Yeah.
That was Watertown, right?
And I
mentioned to all of the other districts yet once again that we have to come up with about 75% of all of our budget from our taxpayers, not the state.
Right.
Whereas the other components
and
are different.
Yes. Maybe they don't listen to me when I talk. I don't know.
I can't believe that.
You guys.
Yeah, I love to comment, Pat, about how being a mother and having worked with college students, you're used to not being listened to.
Yes. Yes. Well, I don't know. It just every time I bring it up, there's just total surprise but it has to be done.
I'm going to move the TST BOCES capital project agreement be set aside until such time there's resolution at the state on the tax cap.
Second. Are we set a vote or is it?
That's why I did it that way.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think I need an interpretation of what that would mean, Brad. It wouldn't come back and we just wouldn't deal with it until.
The
governor signed something with the legislature.
I don't know. I'm a little. I mean, I appreciate that. I guess I'd be more comfortable just like putting it aside until we have that other clarification on information. Because if we totally wait for the legislature, then I mean, we wonder if one like the roof starts to fall in, and then we're like, I'm sorry, we can't do it because.
Well,
so
here's the question. Suppose. The New York State Legislature doesn't fix this. Let's just go out on a limb and suppose they don't fix it in May or June. Mm-hmm. What then will we do as a sizable component of BOCES?
We'll vote. We'll bring it up.
We'll have to decide what we're going to do with it.
Mm-hmm. We bring it up. We vote no. We hope our colleagues around the state continue to vote no. And then eventually the message will be loud and clear.
Because it isn't just this BOCES.
Yeah, it shouldn't just be
it
our responsibility.
It is not just this BOCES. It is a statewide issue. It is apparently our issue within this component BOCES because we are so much different economically than all of our other BOCES colleagues.
We're discussing right now the resolution on the table. I'll only add my two cents, which I usually don't try to do. But at this point, I would give BOCES I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt to come back and explain all this to me before I say, okay, I'm waiting for Governor Cuomo to do something that I want him to do. He hasn't done anything that I've wanted him to do since he's been in office. So I would just, we will vote on the Brad's motion.
Who seconded?
Well, but it didn't, isn't Ann raising a question about the wording of it, which is that, you know, are we not going to address this again until the legislature fixes this, which might be never.
Or hell freezes over.
Right. Right. And then, meanwhile,
we'll have to figure out how to fix BOCES. Yeah. So.
Don't work for it.
Right, exactly.
You don't vote for it, and then you offer another.
Then you offer something else.
Another resolution that we vote on.
You offer something else. Mm-hmm.
That's
fine.
Yeah, exactly.
So, can I just? So, Amanda, are you the point person for this with BOCES?
Oh, I hope so.
Sure, I can be. I mean, where I got this information was we meet every other month as business officials, and so that was the time that I received this packet of information that I'm referring to. And then the only other time is when, you know, they talked about it here during the roadshow, but it was really their roadshow, but it was sort of...
Somebody tell me that was a board meeting that I missed.
Just let me do their admin budget.
I was there for the admin budget, but I just didn't.
Yeah.
It was a finance committee meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. It was a finance committee meeting. So I would certainly like to give our BOCES colleagues the courtesy of trying to make their case more plainly now that we know where we stand and give them a chance to see if it would change our mind. I would even come to a finance committee meeting for that.
I'm happy to.
Now I know hell will freeze over.
I've been to one or two.
I know, you have.
And if your preference is for finance and facilities, we can do that. If your preference is to invite them to a board meeting, we can do that.
I would cede to the full board. It's probably hard for everyone to get to finance and facilities, no matter what you guys think.
I just want to say clearly, for me, this is not about changing my mind. I mean, we've already made it clear. We appreciate BOCES. They made the presentation about some of the things they want to do in the future, which certainly benefit our babies. We don't want the roof to collapse or any kids. I get all that. But the issue we're dealing with is a structural issue and something political. And what they could convince me of is that they, as an organization, have gotten together with their colleagues around the state and have done the requisite work to shift what's happening at all.
She's done it,
right?
Yeah.
I want to see their letters. That's what will change my position, not coming to present on details, right? We kind of get what's going on.
Okay. Well, motion was made, seconded, it's been discussed, and I guess we'll all in favor. That's Chris, Moira, and Brad. Those opposed? That would be me, Eldred, and Ann. Those abstaining would be Pat and Nicole.
I so, go up there every year.
I know, so we. So I didn't quite. What was the results of the vote?
3-3-2.
It failed.
Right, it did not pass. So we're
kind of. Is somebody going to move the resolution, or are they going to move something else?
Well, I would like to go with what Rob was saying. I don't know, you could say it better.
Well, I don't typically do resolutions.
Okay, well, I don't know. I like the idea of having them come back and explain. Somebody can put this in resolution language and explain the specifics. What we would need this year, and two, to Eldred's point, if we pass this, what's the commitment they would be making to helping us to change this so that we can, going forward, it could be, you know, excluded from the tax cap. So I don't know how that's
I would worry about saying yes, we'll do this if you promise that you'll start helping us.
Yeah.
They had a long time to do that. And I'm sure they're out there lobbying.
There's no resolutions. A motion can be really short, and that motion can be very simply something. Eldred, you want to do?
Pat, what you just said is the key for me. You said you're sure they're out there lobbying. I'm not sure. That's all I'm saying.
I thought she was being sarcastic.
Oh, no, I actually wasn't. I often sound sarcastic when I'm not. My kids bring it up all the time. No, I'm sure they are out there lobbying. I'm sure they're out there lobbying.
Sure they're out there
lobbying. Okay,
I do believe it. I don't know.
All right, I'll do
it. I'm trying to make it short. I offer a motion to have the principals at BOCES agree to come and speak to us, even if we have to call a special meeting because of their time crunch, so that we can hear from them in a more precise level of detail what is at stake for us in 16-17 and moving forward.
I would second that, which means I'll support it.
Okay. Move second.
Is it a request for us to invite them? Just so I'm clear.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's the motion. If they ever want to get a resolution passed, they need to come back. So, Eldred made a motion. Pat seconded.
I did second it.
Pat seconded. We've talked about it. All in favor? That's Pat, Rob, Moira, Eldred, Ann, and Nicole. Those opposed? Those abstaining, well, are you, was that an abstention or are you opposed?
No.
Opposed? You two are opposed?
No, I'm abstaining.
So, all right, Chris is abstaining.
This is the most
exciting. This is the most exciting board meeting we've had in a long time.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
No, it's that, you know, that $124 million thing. I can't get anybody to even ask questions, but. And I can't believe you're going to. $50,000 for development? Are you kidding? No, we're good at $124 million, but we're three zeros. That's great. We're three zeros.
Yeah, I think yes.
The three zeros sold.
I would just offer just whether it's a finance or full board meeting, whatever. It's going to be in public. It's not. This is obviously not a private topic. We just need more info if they want something from us, and we want to do something for our students up there, then we're going to have to find out more, right? So thank you for motioning and doing all that stuff. And we love budget night, Dr. Brown. I mean, it's only 9 o'clock. I mean, we barely.
I guess if they want an answer soon, they'll want to come and talk to us soon.
Wow.
I think we'd assume.
We're here. We're here all week. The show never ends. Are we? Exactly. The upcoming meetings, anything else anybody wants to talk about, budget or anything? Students in the back, you still here? Way to be, guys. Very good. Wednesday, there's an audit committee meeting. We do have enough for that committee. Next week, policies, other stuff. Anything? Anything for the good of the group? Other announcements? I'm just looking at Pat.
Policy next week, next Tuesday, as always. Every non-board meeting, we're meeting for policy, as far as I know. Moira, is it a joint one next time?
No, it's not a joint one.
Okay, so it'll be at 5 o'clock then?
Yes.
That's May 2nd, joint one, looks like.
Joint one, May 2nd.
All right. Policy rocks. Here we go. All right. So we'll... anything else without objection? We are adjourned. Thanks, everybody.